ladies and gentlemen. My name is Cameron Munter. I am the president and CEO of the EastWest Institute. I am a recovering diplomat, which means that until 2012, I was in the American Foreign Service, and I had the honor and good fortune to work with some people who are in this room, with the ambassador, current ambassador from Serbia, Ambassador Makovic. We have with us also Madam Consul General Jivković from Serbia. But I also had the opportunity as ambassador in Serbia to work with Vuk Jeremić when he was foreign minister. And they often say in diplomacy that it's easy to negotiate in good times when you agree on things. But you really find out what people are made of in tough times. And I was in Serbia when Vuk was foreign minister in tough times. Times the independence of Kosovo and other issues that really were difficult to deal with. And what I found is that Vuk is someone who is the highest intellectual caliber, very tenacious, keeps going even when foreign ambassadors tell him to stop, but does so in a way where he's always able to smile and to serve up a great glass of red wine when the issues are raised. Here at the East-West Institute, what we try to do is what I think Vuk Jeremić will be talking about today, which is we try to talk about diplomacy in the 21st century, a new kind of diplomacy, a diplomacy which will try to harness multilateralism, the highest expression of which is the UN, to the purposes of new challenges that are like interstate issues, proliferation, climate change, counterterrorism, things of that sort, trying to deal with those big problems, not with the usual cast of characters, not with just leaders of countries, but with business leaders. There are a couple of those among us today as well. With NGO leaders. That is to say, if these problems are big and diffuse, the people who will solve them are also big and diffuse. That makes the job of United Nations Secretary General all the more complex in the 21st century. It's not simply enough to be the person who guides the many nations of the UN. It also guides towards solutions of issues that will involve NGOs, which will involve businesses, to try to deal with a broader world, a global world, not just an international world. It's not just state to state, it's global issues. And that's where we hope, we at the East-West Institute, where we anticipate problems and try to build trust so that those problems can be addressed. That's where we hope we can make a contribution in the kind of world that a UN, whether Vuk is running it or not, that the UN is going to have to confront, and we want the world to confront. So thank you for joining us at the East-West Institute, where we are, again, anticipating problems, finding solutions, building relations. We do work in China, we do work in Russia, in the Middle East, et cetera. And we will be very much engaged in years to come, and hope that many of you will be engaged with us as well. Now, Vuk Jeremić is someone who has a strong background, as I mentioned to you. He was foreign minister in Serbia. He served as president of the General Assembly of the United Nations. He is now running a think tank, which is in the forefront of addressing security and broad international issues around the world. So that when I say that I think the job that he is looking for is one that will take a multitude of different kinds of backgrounds and perspectives, certainly Vuk is one of the people who knows those perspectives, who's worked in those many areas. So what I'd like to do today is to have a little conversation with Vuk, ask him all those tough questions I was too nice to ask when I was ambassador, right? But then open up to a discussion with all of you so that you can ask someone who could very well be the next Secretary General of the United Nations what you think he ought to think about, what you think he ought to do, and how he ought to do it. So Vuk, maybe a couple of words from you to start.
Well, thank you very much, Cameron, for this most kind introduction. It is indeed a great privilege to be here and to address the East-West Institute. It's an exceptional privilege to be again with Cameron. We did work together at times which weren't that easy, and we remained friends throughout, and our differences that had at the time did not prevent us from continuing to work together for a greater good and for things in which both of us believe in. Having served as Foreign Minister of Serbia for close to 6 years, having run a campaign for a major UN post, having won it, and having served as the President of the General Assembly, I did set up a think tank. So Cameron and I are now colleagues. Center for International Relations and Sustainable Development is a Belgrade-based think tank that deals with issues globally. Once upon a time, our country, Yugoslavia, was its name at the time, was an international player. It did have a number of institutions that engaged throughout the world. The Center for International Relations and Sustainable Development is an attempt by a number of good friends of mine who did serve with me at certain times to bring global discourse back to the Balkans and Serbia in particular. But this is not about center this afternoon. It's about another race. It's about the race for the UN Secretary General. The first round of voting is taking place in exactly 1 month from now. And there are a number of issues that are to be addressed. There are a number of candidates who are in this race. But what I think is perhaps most striking is the moment in which this race is being carried on. The world is in a state of flux. It is difficult to argue that we do not live in transformational times. And I think it is difficult to argue that the nature of the challenges that we're facing as humanity in our time is all but global. And therefore, I believe that the UN has a very important role to play in the times to come and in addressing all these challenges. And I'm sure we're going to have much of a conversation in this regard.
So here's your chance, Vuk. Okay, I believe there are 11 other declared candidates, maybe more.
There are 10 others.
10 others.
11 of us.
Okay. Among them are some people who are well known, some less well known. Why you? Tell the audience why, out of these very talented 11 people, what are one or two things that make you different from these people? What are you doing? What would you bring to the UN that they don't have?
Well, before talking about my background, I think I should say maybe one or two words about the platform.
Well, right, it's not just your background, it's your future.
Yeah, exactly. Let's talk about the future. We are in America. It's always about the future. So I decided to do something that hasn't been done until now. And this is actually to put forward a platform, to say exactly what I intend to do because I get like it. And I believe you all got a copy of it. It's interesting because this is the first platform in the history of the UN Secretary General elections. It contains 53 concrete commitments, 53 concrete things that I intend to carry out in case I get elected. They're clustered in different segments to do with sustainable development, to do with climate change, to do with peace and security, to do with human rights, to do with the reform of the organization itself. So, what I think that I'm bringing to the table is a set of concrete ideas that I commit myself to prior to the elections, which I think brings us more into a logic of democracy and election, which is of course something very well known in this country, not everywhere in the world, but in this country in particular. When it comes to my background, when I was a kid, I was a witness of the failure of diplomacy and sudden surge in poverty and war. That was the breakdown of Yugoslavia, the breakup of Yugoslavia. So I was aware of the consequences of the failure of diplomacy. Then I was privileged to serve as foreign minister for close to 6 years. I did serve as a president of the UN General Assembly. I was the first president of the UN General Assembly that was elected after many decades. I also did serve as a president of the Council of Europe. And I worked hard during my respective terms in office to build consensus and to maintain peace and security in my respective fields of duty. Serbia did become a chair country of the OSCE, which did require consensus amongst all the countries of the Northern Hemisphere. That wasn't terribly easy. I did serve as a president of the General Assembly, not in easy times. It was my duty to start negotiations on sustainable development agenda. It was my duty to chair the negotiations on the arms trade treaty, which was adopted during my term in office. There were several other things which I think made me amongst the qualified people for the job. But first and foremost, what I think hopefully you and others, and especially those who vote, will agree, is that I have proposed certain changes. And I have proposed certain changes in a very bold and transparent way. I personally believe that a UN is an invention. I personally believe that the vast majority of member states are not satisfied with the status quo. And I believe that if we do not change our ways and means, that there is a danger that the United Nations is going to suffer the fate of the League of Nations between the two world wars. So for those who think that we're doing just fine and that there is no need to change anything, I'm probably not your kind. For those who believe that we should try and change things in the UN, here's how I propose to do it.
Well, let me take you on that. A lot of people think that in the UN, you have to be really good at consensus. And of course, you have a background that you described where you've been able to get a lot of disparate people to come together. A lot of people are saying that the problem in the UN is the search for consensus eliminates bold solutions, eliminates tough things. Now, you've said in public that one of the primary things you'd like to achieve is some progress on climate change. So let's take climate change as an example. You can't just solve climate change by getting consensus, because you'll get the lowest common denominator. How, to put it crudely, how are you going to knock heads? Let's say you're selected. How are you going to knock heads in a position where all of the traditions are all about consensus, but to really make progress on climate change, you're going to have to really push things forward. How are you going to do that?
Well, first and foremost, I think that last year was a breakthrough year in terms of achieving the Paris Climate Treaty. I think that a great credit has to go to President Obama and to his administration for achieving this. They did manage to bring key players together, China first and foremost, but others in the end followed suit. So we have finished the year 2015 with a historic piece of paper on the table, which is the Paris Climate Treaty. Now, whether or not this is going to be remembered as a phenomenal piece of paper or not depends on how we are going to go about doing follow-up in 2017 and beyond. So I believe that the role of the next Secretary General has to be one of the many things that he or she will have to do, is to be the strongest possible advocate for the implementations of the provisions of the Paris Agreement. Now, that is not going to be universally popular. A lot of people are going to say, well, this costs a lot of money. What may happen in the meantime is yet another financial meltdown, and so on and so forth. But there are some very clear provisions on which all the member states of the United Nations managed to agree. It is to do with the creating of a certain green fund to help member states achieve a transition to low carbon economies by 2050. There are several other provisions that the Secretary General will have to prioritize in terms of setting things, putting things on the agenda, being very generous when it comes to the usage of the microphone and the loudspeaker. And one very practical thing, being able to deploy a team of advisors to member states to help them create their national plans for transition to low carbon economies by the year 2050.
This is an innovation from you, this idea of giving this kind of...
Actually, everybody agreed to their NDCs, that means nationally determined contributions. Now, not all countries in the world have their economies structured so that they can easily make a transition to a low carbon economy. They did make their nationally determined contributions, but it's a very long road to travel from where they're now to the implementation of those. They will need expert help, they will need political help, they will need to have the backing of the international community to do that. The personification of this international community, when it comes to climate change, I believe has to be the next Secretary General, despite all political obstacles, despite the fact that in certain big countries, hopefully not in the US, the leadership after 2017 is not going to be, you know, terribly convinced about the need to do it. But I do firmly believe that this is real. I have a scientific background. I happen to believe very firmly, based on scientific evidence, in climate change. We're the first generation who are feeling the results, the consequences of the climate change, and we also happen to be the very last generation that has a chance to do anything about it. And the only platform, the only multilateral platform that we have with full credibility, comprehensive legitimacy, is the United Nations, the leader of which will have to have it as a priority. That's why I devote large parts of my platform to concrete steps as to what I intend to do in case I get elected in this regard.
That's true. Now, you have to do what is overused as a phrase, which is herding cats. Right? Getting people who are the main members, the big members, the permanent five, to behave. So I have three questions, and they have to do with Russia, China, and of course, the United States. I don't know which one to start with. They're all so good, right? But the first one is, okay, let's say.
Before we get to any of the three, just for everybody to understand, the process of the mechanics of the election is such that any of those three can actually kill you.
So you're here to watch Vuk avoid three times suicide. It's like a magic trick. Let's begin with China. Let's begin with China. There's a dispute going on about the South China Sea. And the dispute about the South China Sea has to do with different interpretations about sovereignty, different interpretations about the rights of different countries to make use of different elements in that country. And to put it in a very simple way, the Chinese claim a historical precedent in their claim. And there are other countries in the region that are looking more towards legal claims. One of the countries, the Philippines, has taken to an international tribunal in The Hague a request for the international tribunal to rule on elements of this. There are indications in the press that the Chinese, if the ruling goes against China, that the Chinese would say that the ruling is not valid. What does the Secretary General do if one of the permanent five members of the UN sees an international tribunal make a judgment and one of the international countries does not abide by that judgment? How does one deal with that issue?
Well, first and foremost, with regard to this particular dispute that is before the Permanent Court of Arbitration, to do with it's a case of Philippines against China. That's not a UN tribunal. It's a multilateral organization. There are a number of parties that have signed up to it. The Secretary General needs to be very careful when it comes to his space of maneuver when it comes to his or her jurisdiction. So it would be highly improper for a Secretary General to get himself or to organization that comes by construction, he or she gets involved. It'll be very, very delicate job for a Secretary General. He could make a comment on decisions of the member states of the United Nations, but not in the context of a process that is not a formal process under the umbrella of the UN. I personally believe that a decision of a major power to leave a multilateral organ, regardless of the fact that it may not be a UN organ, is highly unfortunate. That would be highly unfortunate, that's what
If it were to happen.
Let's not make any prejudice as to what is going to be the result of the ECA, but let's be straight talking here. I personally believe that the UN would benefit from an injection of straight talking rather than just diplomatic niceties. I think it would be a very, very unfortunate decision.
Then what also needs to be a realist and very pragmatic
about the world, about power, the role of the Secretary General is to work with power, to be able to maneuver or to navigate power. It's a world of power. It's always been a world of power. It'll be a job of the Secretary General to work with power. Nobody can tell China what to do. Nobody can tell China to accept the ruling of a court that China doesn't accept. Nobody is capable of telling the United States to ratify the law of the seas, UN Convention on the Law of the Seas. It has to be very pragmatic about this.
But I think that this issue of the South China Sea actually viewed into a wider context.
The South China Sea is a dangerous piece of world geography, given the landscape of power in today's world. And just like 100 years ago, there was a spark in the Balkans that led to the outbreak of a world war that ended up changing everything, I believe that one has to be enormously careful with regard to that particular part of geography, given everything that is going on in the world. And I believe that the role of the UN and the Secretary General in this work could be to engage perhaps more than the current leadership decided to engage in terms of trying to generate trust and the overall atmospherics of dialogue. There are a number of initiatives in that part of the world which I believe could be very useful in diffusing tensions. We just had a visit of Chinese President Belgrade, and we spent a few days talking about a One Belt, One Road initiative. Most of 2015 ended up being a year of discussion at the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. China does want to reach out to its wider neighborhood in this regard. China will find it difficult to do so if the tensions related to the Southeast China Sea continue to rise.
Well,
perhaps the Secretary General can serve as a catalyst and a bridge between those various initiatives so that more dialogue and less confrontation is what is there.
Well, I think, to its credit, China has committed itself to support of the UN as an institution. I think when President Xi came and committed thousands of new peacekeepers and thousands of dollars, you have at least, even if there is the potential for problems, you at least have a commitment to the institution that would be a tool for you.
The United States China relationship is likely to be the most important bilateral relationship of the 21st century. And in order for this relationship not to be perceived as a G2-dominated world, I think that the UN will have to play an important role debating in part of a wider hall whilst respecting preeminence, strength, relative weight, absolute weight of those two big powers. I think that the Secretary General should not shy away from addressing these issues, even with the G2,
even with the two most important world players.
Well, and I think that, you know, we have a lot to learn from Serbia. I don't think there is a tennis player in all of China or in all of the United States who can take on Serbia. So there is there are unique qualities you bring to the job. You know, Vuk also ran the tennis federation in Serbia. So he has a track record of success.
I wouldn't save the best for last. I mean, I did talk about the fact that I was a foreign minister and then as president of the General Assembly, but I wanted to leave for my parting shot. And I did serve as the president of the Serbian Tennis Federation.
Let's turn to our friends in Russia. This is another tough question that comes up, which is that, you know, there have been times when the Russians, in their actions that they've taken in Syria, have sometimes refused to allow UN and World Food Program drops into rebel-held territory in Syria, despite agreements that they've made in Vienna, in the peace talks, which Russia's a member. Clearly, it looks to the outside like there is a question here of Russian interest, but also sometimes a challenge, if you will, to the authority of the United Nations. How would you propose to have the an issue like that be dealt with anyway?
Well, I think that the background to that particular thing that you're raising is actually very complicated. I think that the consequences of that were dreadful. And I think that, unfortunately, currently as a result of this disagreement, there are hundreds, if not thousands, of people who are no longer witnesses as a result of this disagreement. So I think this is highly regrettable. But when it comes to humanitarian duty of the UN, I think, and in particular when it comes to the Middle East, I think that this ought to be viewed in a wider context. I think that the UN is currently failing in a very big way to address the humanitarian needs of the 60 plus million people who are currently displaced refugees throughout the world. I do make some very concrete recommendations as to how to improve it, as to how to move from the 60% achievement when it comes to fundraising to 100% achievement, as to how to view the humanitarian duty as not just providing people with food and shelter, but also assuring their dignity as well and making sure that they do get a chance of achieving a prosperous future. I think it's a much bigger task in our hand. This is, by the detail, a very painful and a very unfortunate one, which I believe should not go unaddressed. Right now, it is going unaddressed by the UN. I'd probably be someone who would not shy away from calling a spade, but I think when it comes to issues related to the Middle East, where I'm afraid we are witnessing a strategic and historic unraveling that might undermine not just the foundations of the Middle East, a quarter of the 100 years, the Sykes-Picot one, but perhaps the foundations of the wider world order. I think that we ought to have a totally revamped, rejuvenated, energized strategy that has to be centered on robust multilateralism, the heart of which is going to be the United Nations of the 21st century.
And I would add that I can prove that Vuk does call a spade when you're disagreeing. And he never hesitated to do it with me. But the point is, as well, that he also backs up this with intellectual efforts. His latest, the latest volume of the publication, Horizons, that comes out of his think tank, does address creative ideas about multilateralism and how indeed the UN really would try to take on these kinds of issues. So he does practice what he preaches on that as well.
And by the way, the issue is awesome. It just came out of press. It has articles by a number of very prominent intellectuals and leaders like Cameron, like Christine Lagarde, like many others. So I do recommend you to subscribe to
that. So I do too, of course. Now I'm going to come to my last question before we throw this open to a discussion with everyone here. And the last question is, as I promised, the third and most difficult country that I was going to mention, which is the United States. In the United States, there's enormous skepticism about the UN. You know, the famous statements about black helicopters, the idea that the UN is this strange, supernatural, almost supernatural, as well as supranational state that can control things, etc. It is given both too much credibility and too little credibility. In other words, it's a PR disaster in the United States. That is, there are a number of other people who are greatly dedicated to it, partners with the UN, from the NGO world, intellectuals, etc. So it's a very complex question that you're dealing with in the United States. How do you propose to work both concretely with the United States, and how would you want to improve, if possible, the image of the UN with the United States, the public of the United States, so there'd be greater support?
Well, first and foremost, I have to say that the United States is not isolated in being, let's say, slightly disappointed with the current state of affairs in the United States. I think that the majority of the world nations are feeling this, are having this sensation of stagnation, perhaps even failure when it comes to the United States. So I think that what we really need is a significant overhaul and rejuvenation of the organization. But when it comes to the United States in particular, I think that introducing more transparency into the work of the UN and into the work of the UN bureaucracy in particular is something that a country like the United States is going to see as a positive move. And the Secretary General cannot move mountains, cannot force permanent members to do things, cannot enforce, for example, a Security Council reform or things of that nature. But what the Secretary General can do, and actually the Secretary General has near to monarchical powers in this regard, is to get the Secretariat, the UN bureaucracy, in shape, to make it more transparent, to make it more lean, to deliver better value for money for the member states. And in order for me not just to talk, niceties, like, yes, we can do better, I actually committed myself to certain things, which some people do consider controversial.
So give us one.
For example, I said, I am not going to appoint anybody to the position of Undersecretary General, and there are 88 Undersecretary Generals. Think of them as cabinet secretaries.
Did you say 8 or 88?
88, I'm afraid. There are 88 Undersecretary Generals. And I commit myself not to appoint anybody who would not be prepared to make a public financial disclosure prior to getting appointed.
So Donald Trump doesn't get to be an
undersecretary. What?
He's available.
He might not be after November. You never know.
You never know. We'll see how it works in the American elections. But no, to be very serious, next to the public financial disclosure, I actually propose a set of other measures, like making the Office of Internal Oversight, which is like an inspector general of the UN. I propose to actually sever the links from the Secretary General to the Internal Oversight, and to appoint somebody entirely independent to be in charge of an oversight. And not to appoint a faithless bureaucrat, but actually a guy with stature, so that he or she would have had decades of experience behind her or him, and be like a former finance minister or a central bank and to be totally independent in terms of his or her action. I intend to create a special proposition how to protect internal whistleblowers. Right now, the record of the United Nations is this one. In 89% of cases of internal whistleblowing, the person who do that would be removed from his or her positions right now. The United Nations have suffered some serious blows recently when it comes to sexual abuse, when it comes to corruption, other forms of abuse. I intend to relentlessly address it in the first 100 days. And I believe that a Secretary General who delivers on this front in the first 100 days, perhaps may be in the position to work more closely and with a higher degree of trust with the host country and with many other countries around the world, and making sure that future initiatives, ideas, grand ideas, and plans get to be implemented with more vigor and more global support that is necessary, given the nature of challenges that humanity is facing in the 21st century.
Well, Vuk, you've given us a notion of how you deal with the outside world, and perhaps even more focused on the inside world of the UN. So that brings us to the point where we get to the really difficult part of our presentation today, which is your questions, right? He's probably ready for anything I can think of, but he may not be ready for what you have in mind. So I wonder if any of you could take advantage of the opportunity to ask the potential Secretary General of the UN any question, no holds barred, please.
Jack Moore, Star Companies. Would you consider moving the United Nations out of New York City?
So did you hear that? Would you consider moving the United Nations out of New York City?
No.
It would be just too expensive. Actually, some people proposed this. The last person who did it was Muammar Gaddafi. actually, the rough estimate of the moving of the UN out of New York to a place in another continent would be close to $25 billion. I think that they're $25 billion probably better spent. I know that New Yorkers will have to continue putting up with a difficult week in September when traffic is collapse, but let's say that I might get to consider it in the second term.
Another question, please.
My name is Jelena Kostic, and I work, I think, already 10 years. I would like to propose you something and one question for you. I'm afraid that your personality is too strong comparing with other 10 candidates. Looking at the CV of other candidates, you are definitely the person with the strongest personality in academic. You know, the my proposal for you to try to be less, how I say, your personality must be a little bit less, because I'm not sure that the big country, this big five, ready to accept too strong personality for the number one in the UN. If they are ready, and we don't know that, then you are a good candidate, and I'm pretty sure that you will win. My question for you is, do you think that these five, big five, is ready to accept it?
It's a very, very good question. And actually, a lot of people in private conversations ask me this question, very knowledgeable people who are very deeply involved in international affairs. Some people ask me about my past and the fact that we had disagreements as a country when I was representing the country as foreign minister and so on and so forth. And I said to them, listen, this is all peanuts in comparison to the big question that you had just asked. The P5, they know me very well.
it'll be pathetic for me to try to pretend that I'm Well, we've worked together. I think that the Q people in Key Capitals know exactly what I stand for when I say that I intend to exercise change. I made sure that I wrote it down so that I do not scare anybody as to what do I mean by change. But I think that the fundamental question that the G5 and the 10 non-permanent members of the Security Council, there are 15 countries in total that are deciding. Is it fair? Is it not fair? This is the system. The 15 countries of the Security Council, amongst which 5 have more weight than others, they're going to be the ones deciding as to who's going to be the next guy. And I said to those 5 and to the others, if you believe that it is in your interest to continue in this direction and at this speed, and if you believe that you, as the biggest shareholders in this company, it is in your interest that we, that the company continue in this direction, you have the right, you have the voting rights, you are the biggest shareholders, you decide what is best for you, I'm not gonna be working. And then at the age of 41, I'll probably end up doing something else in my life. But if you believe that, given this, that we might need reinvigoration of our means and ways, here's how I propose to do it. And please don't forget that I am not looking forward to being an unsuccessful Secretary General. If I get to be elected, I'll try and be successful Secretary General. So I'll try to be a successful CEO. A successful CEO cannot do so being confronted and at odds with its biggest shareholders. That is the B5 in this case.
Don't forget my question. They are ready or not?
We'll know on July 21. When the voting has taken place.
Another question, please.
As the Secretary General, you have to understand the past, operate in the present, and predict the future. As we look at the future, how do you think India plays in that future?
Well, as Yogi Berra said, it is very difficult to make predictions, especially about future. But on a serious note, India is the world's largest. And it is soon going to become the world's most populous state, a very significant global, not just continental player. It's one of the biggest contributors when it comes to the UN in terms of personnel for peacekeeping. And I personally see an acceleratingly significant role when it comes to both representation and otherwise for India in the United Nations. If countries like India are not part, an integral part of the future order, UN or other, any other order, I think one cannot talk about comprehensibility and legitimacy of that particular order. So a lot of people have recently spoken about the demise of India from international institutions, India being frustrated and giving up on certain organizations. Well, one of my key geopolitical, if you will, points of attention are going to be to make sure that there is more India and not less India in whatever we do.
Maybe I could follow up on that in a very general way. There are a lot of people who talk, a lot of, not only people, but a lot of interests who talk about the need for a reform of the structure of the UN Security Council. you now have 5 permanent members and 10 members that rotate over time from the membership, based on a system that has to do generally with regions of the world. A number of suggestions have been made about changing the UN Security Council, which after all was put into place in 1945. I'm not going to ask you what the results should be, because no one can know, but how would the process work? What if you were to be the Secretary General, what kind of process would you like to see to address the question of reform of the UN Security Council?
This is one of the most politically toxic and delicate topics right now in the UN. And I chair as President of the General Assembly. I was in charge of negotiations on Security Council reform for 1 year, 2012-2013. And unfortunately, there was no progress in that particular year. To my understanding and knowledge, there was no progress since as well. And to be very honest, there was no progress since 1945 when it comes to the structure of the Security Council. Now, the reality is that, you know, the world of 1945 and the world of 2016 is these are vastly different. And if one wants to have 21st century United Nations playing the role that the UN has played in the second half of the 20th century, this will have to change. Now, this is something that is truly exclusively falling within the purview of member states, and it's not the Secretary General's role to lead it or to advocate any particular solutions. But if I get elected in 2016 and if I begin my term in 2017 and if I get to serve 2 terms in office, I consider myself a not so successful Secretary General at the end of my term, second term. Is such that my successor gets to be elected exactly in the same way and exactly by the same actors as I will have get hopefully elected later this year.
So there's, at this point, if I hear you correctly, it's not in the purview of the Secretary General to really be out in the forefront on this, but that you say that for the UN to function in the way that it should as a representative body, It obviously has to make those changes.
It has to be
inserted in the next decade.
I mean, the world of 2016 and let alone 2026 is a world vastly different from the one that we had at the end of the Second World War.
Yeah, seems that way. All right. Other questions? Other tough, unsolvable things you'd like to do? Please.
Hello, Mr. Jeremić. My name is Burak. I'm from Peace Silence Institute. As you know, last year on December, the UN Security Council has adopted a resolution outlining a peace process in Syria, but disagreements still remain over the Syrian President Bashar al-Assad. If you become elected, if you become the Secretary General of the United Nations, would you consider focusing more on this resolution, since the situation in Syria and the situation about refugees are getting worse and worse?
Well, when I served as president of the UN General Assembly, that was 2012 and 2013, and in my closing speech, I said that my biggest regret and the fact that I feel ashamed of was that the Syrian tragedy has not gotten any better throughout my term. There were limited things. I mean, it was a limited thing. Limited space of what I could do as a president of the General Assembly, but that was 4 years ago. That was 3 years ago. 3 to 4 years ago. I believe that this is the biggest tragedy that we've had at our hands since the end of Second World War. And And I believe that this is now having profound consequences for peace and stability throughout the world, starting with Europe. The refugee crisis would be a stark reminder of the consequences of this crisis. The world is in suspension, and people are waiting for the American elections to be over. I'm not going to say that the world is waiting for the UN Secretary General elections to happen, but that might bring change. But I think that the next year, 2017, is going to be a critical year when it comes to the wider Middle East, to the greater Middle East challenges and the consequences of what's currently going on there. There are several things that I commit myself to in my platform and that I'm talking about pretty openly. One is to do with more agile UN diplomacy in this regard. There were several Secretary General's envoys that have been trying very hard. Perhaps the time has come for Secretary General to have no envoys, but to be his own envoy when it comes to this. But there are a number of practical issues that need to be done. Some of them in the field of humanitarian action, but some of them in terms of the future of peacekeeping when it comes to the UN. In the end of the day, we will come, hopefully this day is not going to be far too distant in the future, but we are going to come to an agreement and to some kind of an arrangement with regard to Syria and Yemen and other parts of the Middle East. But the future of the UN peacekeeping, which I elaborate on in detail in my platform, has to be very different from the current peacekeeping that we have. And therefore, I do propose that over a five-year period, and I propose how exactly, we come to generate a new generation of peace stabilization missions. No longer just peacekeeping, but peace stabilization missions of the United Nations that will have a much more robust rule of engagement and having in mind, in particular, the challenges emanating out of the Middle East. I also propose that the UN takes a more agile stance with regard to countering terrorism and violent extremism, and also empowering countries and helping and assisting member states who are in a position to need such assistance to get it, that kind of expertise from the UN. That is a leap from the blue helmet peacekeeping of the 20th century. But I do not see much value in continuing to think about peacekeeping where there is no peace to keep. And therefore I think that we need to think about a significant overhaul of that particular dimension of the organization.
In that sense, well, do you ascribe to the idea that others have talked about peace making, peacekeeping, peace building, that is to take a more sequential approach? Do you buy that? And if you do, do you think the entire organization can be part of that?
I think that the entire organization has to graduate into that kind of thinking, because the world has moved on. And if the organization is going to maintain its relevance that it didn't have in the 20th century, it has to move with the developments. Right now, the pace of developments in the world is much higher than the pace of change in the UN. And peace and security is a particularly delicate aspect of delivering global goods, which the UN, I believe, is ultimately about. I mean, it has to evolve on that front. And I think that that powerful countries and advanced militaries of the world, like the United States, for example,
will have to play a critical role in transitioning, in helping the organization transition itself from the 20th century niche where it's still kept into something that will be much more useful and relevant for the world.
Are there further questions?
Okay. You just reminded me, Vuk, of the best business card that I ever received in my life. It was somewhere in Silicon Valley from one startup, and it said, Chief Disruptor. And I said, this is my dream position. But in a way, I see you as someone who could be perceived as disruptive force. And in that sense, in a way, scary for the huge bureaucracy that prefers inertia, as we all know. With your coming in, do you think that, and they know you, as you said, do you think that the mere fact that they know how you think and how you act can actually endanger your position or weaken your position within the General Assembly?
Well, there are good news and bad news about this. The bad news is that that you're right, and that bureaucracy in the United Nations in particular is seeing me as a threat. And when I decided to run for president to the General Assembly, it was that very same bureaucracy that came to me and said, you know, this will be the end of the General Assembly if you force a democratic election for president. Because we've been working this by consensus for many decades, and it will be the end of our organ. And I said, well, I see this as an exercise in democracy, and let the exercise in democracy be the end of the organ, because if democracy brings something to an end, it means that this something might have not been ideal in the first place. The General Assembly did not fall apart as a result of my being democratically elected president of the General Assembly. Now, those very same people are, to be honest, very strongly against my becoming Secretary General, because Secretary General is the chief administrative officer among the things. So far, we mostly spoke about somebody being Wells' chief diplomat. It's also chief administrative officer. And the administration's not terribly enthusiastic, or at least not everybody's terribly enthusiastic about the prospect of somebody trying to change the institution. But those are bad news. Good news are that they're not voting. The people who are voting are the political leaders. The people who are instructing their ambassadors how to vote are political leaders of the countries that are sitting in the Security Council. And five of them have a very significant role to play because they're permanent members of the Security Council. It is the political leaders who will decide what kind of vision they want for the organization, which happens to be the only multilateral platform of universal membership and comprehensive legitimacy that we will have in our times. So it is up to them to decide what is best for their respective countries and for the world, and I have a great trust in their leadership.
Well, one of the things that's come up is something you can't do much about, really, is that there's been a lot of talk that it's time for a woman to be the leader of the Security Council. Among the candidates are Helen Clark from New Zealand, Susan Malcora, Argentina. We have Irina Bokova from Bulgaria. I believe even Vesna Pusic from Croatia, etc. So,
Natalia
German from Moldova. In other words, these are not only impressive women, but women who have, many of whom have experience in the UN system as you do. So it's an impossible question. Right, but I'll ask it anyway. How do you answer the claim that it's time for a woman to run the organization when you're not running at all?
Nobody's perfect.
Nobody's perfect, yeah, exactly.
That's one way of answering it, and a good way of answering it. Nobody's perfect. But quite honestly, I believe that come what may, this election is a watershed moment for the UN in many ways, including in a way in which the role of women are going to be in the UN. So I think this should be, in my opinion, a critical moment for the role of women in your organization, whoever ends up winning. Man or a woman. And it is very difficult to argue against, you know, electing a woman being a very powerful symbolism. This is certainly the case. But I think it perhaps goes beyond this symbolism, no matter how this symbolism may be important. And believe it or not, in 1995, the United Nations have made after long negotiations, they have made a declaration. It was signed in Beijing. It was called 1995 Beijing Declaration on Gender Equality, in which they said by the year 2000, there'll be a 50-50 gender parity in the Organization of the United Nations. And that was 16 years ago, the term began. It failed miserably. It's far beyond 50%. And when it comes to the high-level appointments in the UN, that is the roles of Undersecretary General, only 24% are women. Now, Secretary General appoints all 88 Secretary Generals that they want. So all of them have to step down, so the Secretary General appoints Undersecretary Generals that they want. So I made myself publicly committed to achieving gender parity in Undersecretary positions on day one. So come January 2, there'll be 44 women undersecretary generals. And that's just a start. I actually did devise a detailed plan on how to make full gender parity in the organization by the end of my first term in office. That is the year 2020. But it's not just about the numbers. There are several UN resolutions that deal with it, that are measuring how advanced the role of women is here and there. I mean, some of these matrices are pretty pathetic. For example, one of the most important matrices is like how many times the word woman is mentioned in a UN resolution. I think what really needs to address this issue far more seriously. I do. I hope to be able to carry it out if I get elected. If there is a woman Secretary General, I really hope that she does it too. Because I don't think it's just enough to be a woman in order to be serious and to address the issue of gender equality, not just in the organization, but when it comes to the right of women and the role of women throughout the world. That is certainly going to be one of my priorities if I get a chance to be here, if I get a chance to show.
Further questions? Yes, we have one back here.
Hi, my name is Shannon Corbett. I'm also with the East Islands Institute. It's clear that you were integral to the creation and implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals. And that being said, you know, you've voiced your passions about climate change and your wishes to, you know, be more active with Syrian refugees and in Syria. Just tend to bring it back to the Sustainable Development Goals, which, you know, with all of this information, do you see as the most important to address?
Well, one thing that I did not know too much about when I became president of the General Assembly, when I was elected president of the General Assembly, was sustainable development. I had no choice but to be confronted with this early on. It was my job to set up a framework for negotiations. I'm not claiming that I'm an expert on sustainable development right now, but I'm much more knowledgeable now than I used to be.
in the past. I think that the Agenda 2030 and the adoption of the Sustainable Development Goals was a grand breakthrough in diplomatic terms, one of the grand breakthroughs of last year. And there are 17 of them, and there are 169 targets within the 17. It wasn't easy to negotiate. I was there. I was hoping that there would be fewer goals and fewer targets, but this is what we have. The world is not perfect. And everybody says, well, all of the SDGs are equally important. Long term, I think they are, but I did not shy away from actually saying which particular SDGs I intend to jumpstart. I do intend to help jumpstart certain sustainable development goals, which are to do with building human capital. Because I think building human capital is an essential bootstrapping element of coming to the fulfillment of the Agenda 2030. I know not everybody's gonna like it and not everybody's going to embrace this particular thing that I say, but I think if one wants to be pragmatic and if one wants to go beyond just restating fidelity to the SDGs, one needs to be practical as to what comes first. And I made my choice.
We would add your think tank as sustainable development as its last name.
Sustainable development is my middle name.
The last name of your name. I think we have time for another question, a real blockbuster. I mean, so far you haven't really been able to set him in his tracks. But let's see what we have.
I'm not sure if this is a blockbuster, but I'm going to go ahead anyway. My name is Sanya Rolovich, and I've come into this conversation first and foremost, want to thank you for inviting me. I'm a clinical psychologist, and I've over the years worked with war trauma and also a peace psychologist. And that's the place from which I asked this question, Vuk. Going back to the very first few words that you said, we come from Serbia, we come from Yugoslavia, we come from what is now Serbia. The future of the UN is not going to rely on the future of Serbia. My question to you is, may the future of Serbia that has struggled over the years to move forward, tremendously struggled to move forward, may the future of Serbia possibly somehow benefit from your position in the UN?
Sorry.
Do you see a way that Serbia can benefit down the road from your position in the UN as a General Secretary?
This is a very delicate question because the Secretary General once he's up, first of all, I'm candidate to Serbia and I'm very grateful that I had the chance to run this race as a result of the confidence that the government of Serbia placed in me. But the moment you get elected, the Secretary General is supposed to be fully impartial with regard to all issues, including where he or she comes from. It's, of course, an issue of great prominence that somebody from your country gets the support all the member states of the United Nations. At the end of the day, Secretary General is formally appointed by consensus in the General Assembly. So I think that coming to appoint by consensus somebody to serve as Secretary General who comes from Serbia would contribute to the country's prominence in the international arena. But the Secretary General will have to be very, very, very careful as to how he or she conducts duties in an impartial and a straightforward way. Is that going to be of benefit to Serbia, his or her prominence? I don't know. I mean, maybe it is, maybe it's not. Maybe it's similar to like when Djokovic wins
a grand slam? I believe that the answer is yes, but this is to be judged by the people serving. Yeah.
Right, well, thank you. One last chance. Another one. Okay. Well, thank you also. We have one last question sneaking in under the wire.
Hello, thank you. I was wondering what you see the future role of disputed states and territories being in the United Nations. Obviously, the recognition of Palestine was quite historic, but I'm wondering, as things pertaining to state designation seem to be becoming less and less clear, how do you see that changing in the future? Thank you.
So that is one of the most, I would say, delicate questions. The issues of sovereignty, the issues of territorial disputes. There are certain principles that are laid out in the charter, but there is politics and geopolitics surrounding it. One needs to be, prepared to defend the charter with all of his or her heart. One also needs to be very pragmatic when it comes to this issue, because issues of territory are almost exclusively related to geopolitical realities of the day. When it comes to membership in the United Nations, there's some very clear rules and procedures. What gets you to be an observer? What gets you to be a full member? There are procedures related to the Security Council. There are procedures related to the General Assembly. It's not really Secretary General's job. Secretary General, when it comes to issues of such profound nature, his or her job is going to be to follow what the member states ask him to do through the organs of the United Nations and through the procedures that are not in this regard.
That's such a tough question that what I finally realized after listening to Vuk during this time is, why on earth would anyone want this job? Because here you are going into a job where many people say there's a great probability in the next 5 to 10 years we could have another economic crisis. We are seeing the possibility of the unraveling of Sykes-Picot, and if Sykes-Picot unravels and it has a challenge to the world system, guess who's going to be asked to take part in fixing it? We have these questions like disputed territories, which have been going on since before the beginning of the UN. So all I can say is that my admiration for your ability to suffer and to learn from that suffering in an almost biblical sense has gone up, because if you are successful, you're going to face enormous challenges, the extent of which I think has become clear from many of the questions that come here. So I think all of you, whether or not you find out that you're the one who takes over, you or whoever does take over, we hope we can give all the support we can, because the problems are going to be huge. So Vuk, thank you very much for your time. Please. I hope you'll stay around for just a little bit. We have some wine in the back and a few minutes, and he gets a glass of wine as a thank you all for coming this evening.